जय श्री माता जी। श्रीमद् देवी भागवत। इफ यू वॉन्ट टू नो हु आदि शक्ति इज, रीड देवी भागवत, सेड बाय हर होलीनेस श्री माता जी निर्मला देवी।
संकल्पम्। मम आत्मानः सहजयोगी कुटुंबानां आत्मोन्नति प्रीत्यर्थं मोक्ष प्राप्ति प्रीत्यर्थं साक्षात् श्री आदिशक्ति माताजी श्री निर्मला देव्यै पूजनं करिष्ये। द होली रिसाइटल ऑफ श्रीमद् देवी भागवत।
चैप्टर 3 एपिसोड्स 1-3। किंग जन्मेजया रिक्वेस्ट श्री व्यास जी टू टेल अबाउट द प्रिंसिपल गॉड्स, द क्रिएशन ऑफ द यूनिवर्स एंड द मीनिंग ऑफ स्वरूप। श्री ब्रह्मा डिस्क्राइब्स टू नारदा द ग्लोरी एंड मैग्निफिशेंस ऑफ भगवती आद्य शक्ति। श्री देवी प्रोवाइड्स अ सेलेस्टियल वेहिकल एंड टेक्स श्री ब्रह्मा विष्णु एंड महेश ऑन अ टूर ऑफ द यूनिवर्स एंड देयर फाइनल डेस्टिनेशन द अबोर्ड ऑफ भगवती आदिशक्ति। King Janmejay said, O foremost of sages, you have given us permission to perform the most holy rites of Navratra, 9 nights of worship to the goddess. Kindly deign to tell us, who is this Devi? How and when did she manifest? What was the purpose of her manifestation? And what attributes adorn her? What is Amba Yajna and what are the rules and procedures to be observed? O compassionate one, please explain in detail. Also, please tell how the universe came into being. Because, O Brahmin, what is it, how it is, and all that is said about it is known to you completely. I have heard that Sri Brahma, Sri Vishnu, and Sri Rudra are all possessed of qualities and attributes, and respectively, they are responsible for creation, preservation, and destruction. O son of Parashar, I desire to hear all this in great detail. Vyasji said, You have great intelligence. What you have asked is a very extensive and difficult subject. Many questions arise out of it. Many years ago, I had asked Naradji these questions and whatever he replied, I remember it well. I am going to tell you, listen well. It happened one day that Sri Narada, ocean of complete knowledge, was seated on the banks of the holy river Ganga. I had the honor of meeting this most wise and intelligent being. He was the embodiment of peace. It gave me great joy to see him. I went and prostrated at his feet. When he gave me permission, I sat there on the sand. At that time, sage Narada was in a secluded place beside the river and sitting on a mound of sand. After the formalities of greeting, I spoke to Sri Narada. I said, O Muni, you are most wise. Please be kind and tell me who is the creator of this entire cosmos and its myriad universes. From where did it all originate? Also, please tell me, is it eternal or will it be annihilated? Is it the work of a single creator or are many responsible for its manifestation? Without a doer, nothing can happen. Some people believe Sri Shankar to be the cause and the creator of the world. They say he is imperishable and immortal. He neither takes birth nor does he die. He is engrossed in Atma. He governs all the gods. He is possessed of all the three modes, but he is detached from them. He is ever ready to deliver us from the worldly illusions. Therefore, he is the primary cause of the creation, preservation, and destruction. There are others who extol the glories of Sri Vishnu. He is beyond perception. He is possessed of majestic glory and supremacy. He is omnipotent. By his grace, you get faith, devotion in your worship, and mukti, freedom from bondage. He is omnipresent, all-pervading, refuge of the world. He is unborn and does not die. Some others name Brahma as the prime cause of the cosmos. The credit for creation of all living and non-living things is given to him. This most superior of gods, having four faces, manifested from the lotus of the Nabhi of Sri Vishnu. Surya is worshipped as the creator by sun worshippers who sing his praises morning and evening. Those who worship Indra sing his praises at yagyas. He has 1,000 eyes and he is verily the god of all living beings. He has the titles receiver of yagyas and lord of Trilok, three worlds. He is the enjoyer of the sacrifice and is entitled to drink somras, ambrosia. Various others worship as the creator, Varun, god of rain, Agni, fire, Pavan, wind, Yama, god of death, Kuber, god of wealth, and Sri Ganesh. They maintain that the god with the face of an elephant removes all obstacles and gives success to all actions. And then there are the wise and learned who say that Bhavani fulfills all desires. She is Adi Maya, the many-faceted Devi whose form and character are beyond the mind. Adi, beyond, primordial. She is the great power and she resides within the creation and pervades it. There is no difference between her and Brahma. She is engaged in creation, preservation and dissolution. She is the mother of the gods and all living beings. She is unborn and does not die. She rules the cosmos. Some of her names are Vaishnavi, Shakti of Vishnu, Shambhavi, Shakti of Shiva, Brahmi, Shakti of Brahma, Varuni, Shakti of Varun, Varahi, Shakti of Vishnu as a boar, Narasimhi, Shakti of Vishnu as Narasimhan, Parameshwari, goddess with four arms worshipped by Shiva, and Mahalakshmi, the great lord and ruler of the universe. She is the source of the Vedas. She is pure knowledge, Nirmal Vidya. She is the support of the universe. She destroys the greatest of sins. She removes the afflictions of the universe. She is the foundation of all the organs of beings and is ever present within all beings. She grants moksha to those who wish to be liberated, and she grants victory and success and good fortune according to their desires. When she becomes the creation, she assumes the form of the three gunas, sattva, rajo and tamo. These gunas expand from her and pervade the cosmos. She is also beyond the gunas. She is of the form of attributes and yet she is devoid of attributes. Some of her aspects are Vaishnavi, Shakti of Vishnu, Shambhavi, Shakti of Shiva, Brahmi, Shakti of Brahma, Vasavi, Shakti of Indra, Varuni, Shakti of Varun, Varahi, Shakti of Vishnu in the form of a boar, Narasimhi, Shakti of Narasimhan, and the most worshipful Mahalakshmi. The whole universe is her form. She is the support of the universe. When she is pleased, she eradicates all diseases and woes. Holy and learned sages say that she who is Niranjana, unstained by any limitations whatsoever, Nirakara, formless, Nirlepa, untouched by various karmas and dualisms, Nirguna, attributeless, beyond the three gunas and the three nadis, she is consciousness, devoid of qualities and attributes of the mind, and the all-pervading divine source of the universe, the Creator. In the Vedas and Upanishads, she is described as the divine source, the brilliant light of divine knowledge. She is the primordial being. She has 1,000 eyes, arms, ears and feet. There are others who call the Creator Purushottam or Virat. Others, atheists, say that there was never any Creator, that the universe has always existed and will continue to exist. They do not recognize Prakriti or Purush to be the creators. King Janmejay said, all the gods are standing on Sattva Guna, but the evil demons trouble them constantly. Then, where is the Maryada of Dharma? My ancestors, the Pandavas, were Dharmic people. Still they had to face so many trials and tribulations from time to time. O Muni Vyasji, you are learned and spiritually strong. Please remove all these misapprehensions and doubts from my mind. This world is an ocean of illusion. Please guide my boat across. I am constantly tossed around and I do not wish to sink. Vyasji said, O strong armed one, among kings you are the foremost. The very same questions that you are asking me, I had asked most respectful Naradji, and he said, Vyasji, a long time ago I too was beset by these questions. I went to my father, the radiant and effulgent Sri Brahmadeva. I asked him, O revered father, please tell me, from where has this universe come into being? You have created various things. Is Sri Vishnu the supreme creator, or is Sri Shiva the one who created the cosmos? O great God, you are the soul of the world. Please tell me clearly which gods have to be worshipped and who is the most supreme. O sinless Brahmaji, please have compassion on me and fulfill my heart's desire to know all these things. O son of Satyavati, Vyasji, when I pleaded thus, my father, the god Brahma, began to speak. Sri Brahmadev said, Son, what can I say? This is a very intricate question. O fortunate one, you can get the complete answer from Sri Vishnu. In this whole world, there is no being who has been able to comprehend this mystery. Only the person who has renounced, who is detached, who is desireless, and who is without envy, jealousy, anger, and conceit, becomes worthy to receive this knowledge. In the beginning, there was only water all around. There was no life form, movable or immovable. I came into being in a lotus. The sun, moon, trees, mountains, nothing existed. I sat on the stalk of the lotus and began to wonder. In this endless expanse of water, how did I come into existence? Who is my protector? And in this desolate place, who is the supreme being who creates and destroys? There is no earth visible anywhere. Then what is supporting this vast expanse of water? From where did this lotus originate? Whether born or derived, there has to be some causal. If it is derived, then there has to be a connection, and that connection is mire or clay for the roots. But there is no soil anywhere. Contemplating thus, I descended into the water. For 1,000 years I searched but could not find the beginning or the end of water. Just then I heard a celestial voice, Meditate, meditate. I returned to the lotus and went into meditation for 1,000 years. At the end of that, the same voice was heard, You must create. I was awestruck. What must I create? What is my responsibility? Suddenly, two demons, Madhu and Kaitab, appeared and stood before me in terrifying form. They challenged me to fight upon the waters. I became terrified. I slid down the lotus stalk into the water. There, a most amazing and wonderful sight met my eyes. I beheld a most magnificent being, dark like a rain-filled cloud. He was clad in a pitambar dhoti, yellow colored. He had four arms. He reclined in a couch on the belly of Sheshnag. He was wearing a garland of Vaijayanti. He carried in his hands his weapons, cones called Panchajanya, discus called Sudarshan Chakra, mace called Kaumodaki, and lotus. I had the unique privilege of a darshan of the Lord sleeping on the coils of the serpent Sheshnag. Under the influence of Yoganidra, he was in deep slumber. All his faculties were still. O son Narad, seeing the Lord thus, lying inert made me very anxious. Then I remembered Bhagavati Yoganidra. I began to sing her stutis, praises. The most auspicious and benevolent Bhagavati withdrew from every pore of Sri Vishnu and took her seat in the heavens. Immediately, Sri Vishnu got up and sat. He engaged in battle with the demons Madhu and Kaitab for 5,000 years and finally killed them. One glance from the Devi sent them into illusion and confusion. Then, Sri Vishnu lay them on his lap and beheaded them. After that, there were only two of us, the Lord and I. Sri Rudra arrived at the same place and all three of us got a darshan of Bhagavati Adya Shakti. We were completely enamored. We sang the most elevating stutis and pleased the Devi. Then our ears were most fortunate and blessed to hear her divine and most auspicious voice, Vani. Devi, Bhagavati Adya Shakti said, Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwar, now you can seriously start your execution of duties, creation, protection and dissolution. That is what you have to perform. Now that the demons have been vanquished, you must establish your abodes, lokas. By your powers, you must create four kinds of subjects. Brahmaji says, the voice of that most worshipful Adya Shakti was sweet, beautiful and joy-giving. We heard it clearly and distinctly. We said, O wonderful mother, how are we to accomplish creation of subjects and other activities? There is no earth visible anywhere. There is only endless expanse of water. We would require the five elements, qualities and subtle forms of matter, energies. But there are also non-existent. After listening to all the difficulties and hurdles, we were putting forward that most auspicious Devi Bhagavati gave a most beautiful smile, and in a moment, a wonderful airborne vehicle descended from the skies. The Devi beckoned us, Devas, have no fear, come into this vehicle. Brahma, Vishnu and Rudra, I am now going to show you some amazing and wonderful sights. We obeyed with respect and reverence. We entered the gem-studded vehicle and sat down. It was decorated with strings of translucent pearls. They were tiny bells making a tingling sound. The grand vehicle resembled Amravati, abode of Indra. Seeing us seated in full control of our senses, the Devi with her powers caused the vehicle to fly into space. Brahmaji says, traveling with the speed of thought, it arrived at a strange and unrecognizable place which was filled with trees laden with various kinds of fruits. The sight was enhanced by the melodious calls of the cuckoo. The scenery was beautiful, with vast expanses of earth, majestic mountains, dense forest and groves. There were innumerable men and women, animals and birds, holy rivers, lakes, wells, ponds, ditches, springs and waterfalls. Further on, we saw an extremely beautiful city. It was surrounded on all four sides by imposing walls. There were many stately mansions inside. In a suitable place, a yagyashala was erected, canopy for performing havans and sacrificial ceremonies. Seeing that beautiful city, we desired to admire it closely. We felt this is heaven, but who created it? The city was magnificent and the saintly inhabitants were radiant like gods. They were hunting in the forest. We kept staring at them and admiring the goddess Jagadambika seated in the vehicle. Suddenly, our vehicle got empowered and began to hover in the air. In a moment, it landed in another region. There was a grove extremely pleasing in appearance. Under a fragrant parijat tree, the cow Surabhi was sitting. A little distance away, the glorious elephant Airavat, Indra's chief elephant, was standing. Hundreds of apsaras, yakshas, demigod attendants of Kuber, Gandharvas, celestial musicians and Vidyadhars, demigods, were singing and moving about in the Parijat grove. Also present was God Indra. Enthroned beside him was his Shakti, Sachi. This glimpse of heaven was so wonderful that we were awestruck. the god of the waters Varuna, god of wealth Kuber, god of death Yamraj, the sun god Surya, god of fire Agni, and other gods were all seated on their thrones. We were filled with wonder and amazement. The king of the place was undoubtedly Indra. He was sitting in silence and came out of his palanquin. We were witnessing all this from our vehicle. Again in a moment, our vehicle ascended into the air and landed in the holy Brahmalok, abode of Brahma. All the gods stood with their heads bowed in obeisance. Sitting on the throne was another Brahma. Seeing that, Sri Vishnu and Sri Shiva were greatly surprised. There was an assembly of gods. The Vedas had assumed their respective forms and were seated. The oceans, the seas, the rivers, mountains, and all variety of reptiles and snakes had gathered. Sri Vishnu and Sri Shiva looked at me and said, "O Brahma, who is this imperishable Brahma?" I replied, "I myself am in confusion as to who this creator is, who I am, and what is my purpose." In a moment, our vehicle took to the skies again and we landed on the peak of Kailash. There was a gathering of many yakshas. There was a grove of the celestial coral trees, and parrots and cuckoos enhanced its beauty. Gentle strains of sweet music from veenas and tambourines filled the air. As our vehicle landed, there emerged from a mansion the three-eyed Lord Sri Shankar. He was seated on the sacred bull Nandi. He had 5 faces and 10 arms. He had the moon as his crest jewel. He was wearing a tiger skin. His bodyguards on the either sides were Sri Ganesha and Sri Kartikeya. All the Ganas followed, singing the praises of Lord Shiva. We were exceedingly surprised to see all this. Within a second, we left the top of the mountain and reached Vaikunth, where stood the luxurious palace of the beautiful goddess of wealth, Sri Lakshmi. O son Narada, the wealth, the riches, the fortune that we saw there are beyond description. Sri Vishnu was as astonished as we were. The lotus-eyed Sri Vishnu was enthroned. His form was as lustrous as the flower of the linseed plant. He was wearing a yellow garb, which destroys samsara. He had 4 arms. He was seated on king of the condors, Garuda. He was adorned with jewels and ornaments. Once again, we were surprised and confused and looked at each other. We moved again with the speed of wind. We saw a sea with water as sweet as nectar. The waves were rising high and falling again. It was filled with aquatic animals. In the middle was a pleasing dweep island, which had beautiful celestial coral trees and sweet-smelling parijat surrounding it. Luxurious rugs covered the floor of the pavilion and exquisite paintings adorned the walls. Strings of iridescent pearls hung like garlands and entwined the pillars. Outside were the trees of Ashoka, Ketki, that is Kevra, Bakul and Champa, which perfumed the air. Cuckoos were singing in the trees and divine fragrances wafted from every corner. The buzzing of bumblebees added to the beauty and peace of the surroundings. In the middle, there was a bed covered with rich silk and satin tapestries. The bedstead was inlaid with gold and studded with precious gems and jewels. We were still seated in the vehicle. From a distance, we could see the bed. Many colored sheets, pillows and cushions were strewn on the bed and it shone like a rainbow. And seated on the bed was a most divine and radiant lady. She was bedecked in red robes and red necklaces. Her body was smeared with red sandal paste. Her eyes were of red color, natural white and black of the collyrium. The resplendence of her being was as dazzling as 1,000 suns. She was more beautiful than a crore of Lakshmis. Sri Bhagavati Bhuvaneshwari was holding in 2 hands her weapons of gold and noose, and the other 2 hands had assumed the posture of Abhaydan, granting boons an assurance of protection. Her throne had a golden canopy. Different ornaments and jewels of diamonds and other precious stones adorned her. We had never before beheld such majesty and splendor. Devotees were chanting Hrim, the mantra of the Devi. Others were singing praises of her holy names. Divine maidens were sitting and meditating on some of her names, Bhuvaneshwari, Maheshwari and others. A six-cornered mystical diagram was drawn and inside was enthroned the Devi Bhagavati Bhuvaneshwari. Seeing this splendorous sight, we were transfixed. We began to speak among ourselves. Who is this divine person? What is her name? We have absolutely no knowledge of her. She has 1,000 eyes, 1,000 hands, 1,000 faces. Even from a distance, she shines like the sun and the moon. She is not an apsara, nor she is a gandharva or a divine maiden. Son Narad, making these conjectures, we stayed on there. Then Sri Vishnu, from his inner wisdom, divined that this radiantly smiling and exquisitely beautiful goddess was verily Devi Jagadambika. Then he told us that the Devi Bhagavati was the primordial cause of the existence of all of us. She is also known as Nirmal Vidya and Mahamaya. She is the entire creation. She is indestructible. She can only be worshipped by the wise and the brave. She cannot be worshipped by the cowardly and the stupid. She can be attained by the repeated practice and discipline of yoga. She is the seed energy of the desire of Parabrahma. She is ever young, untouched by time. The entire universe and the Vedas are in her, as she is the mother of the universe. She is called Sadashiva, the sacred spouse of Sadashiva. Her right eye, being the embodiment of the sun, creates day. Her left eye creates the night. Her third eye, like the slightly open golden lotus, creates twilight. She is the matrix of the universe, worshipped by all the gods. She devours the entire creation at the time of Pralaya, the ultimate dissolution. Universe is her form and also the individual self, Vishwa, in the wakeful state in her form. Sri Vishnu said, Brahma and Shankar, she is the ultimate power. The energy manifested in every particle as well as the primordial vibration is she. Her crores of aspects are all enthroned here. You can behold them one by one. These omnipresent forms are adorned with divine ornaments and anointed with heavenly perfumes. Behold Brahma and Shiva. All the goddesses are in attendance on Adya Shakti. Only the very virtuous, generous, compassionate, and those who are detached from worldly desires merit darshan of this most supreme and benevolent goddess Bhagavati Bhuvaneshwari. Those who are self-centered and caught in the web of worldly pleasures never merit darshan of this Mahadevi. She is the total life force of the universe. She is the eternal companion of Sadashiva. The entire act of creation is her play for the pleasure of Sri Sadashiva. He is just the witness and she is the creatrix of the cosmos. She is the primordial power, being the first cause. She is the unitary basis of the plurality of the universe. Sri Vishnu continued, O Brahma and Shiva, this is the Devi whose darshan I had on the desolate waters. I was a baby lying in a cradle of banyan leaf and she was gently rocking me. I was lying with my big toe in my mouth and sucking it and doing all kinds of childish play. My limbs were chubby and soft. I was in the form of a baby and this goddess was singing and rocking me. That was verily this same mistress of the cosmos, Bhagavati Adya Shakti. There is no place for doubt. Seeing her, I remember the past event clearly. The entire universe is in her, as she is the mother of the universe. Whatever I know about her, and whatever experiences I have had, I will tell you. Listen.
The Holy Recital of Srimad Devi Bhagavat.
Jai Srimati Ji.